Hello, and welcome to your daily dose of Star Trek, a collaboration of Married with Comics, John and Maggie, and Batman Books, The Dark Knight in Prose, with me, Lane. We are reading Diane Duane's Star Trek novel, The Wounded Sky, one chapter a day for your quarantined listening pleasure. The Wounded Sky was published in 1983 by Pocket Books. In this episode, I'll be reading Chapter 2. The Wounded Sky, Chapter 2. Starbase 18, in orbit 200 million kilometers from Hamal, could be seen from a long way off, and the sight was lovely. At distance, what one saw was a golden-tinged oblong, rounded at the ends like a cigar, and shimmering delicately as it end-over-ended through space. Closer, though, the size of it became apparent. Other starships, light cruisers, and cutters in for repair or scheduled maintenance were nested among the innumerable spikes and struts and spires of its outer surface. The whole structure glittered in a thousand shades of blinding gold as Starbase 18 tumbled on around Hamal, ponderous and beautiful, and a bit amusing.
"We have our vector, Captain."
"Good, Mr. Sulu. Take us in." Kirk watched with satisfaction as Sulu's fingers flickered over his board.
Thank God no more mail runs, Jim thought. No more boring Starfleet errands for a while. Something big, to stretch my people, to stretch me, he added to himself after a breath.
Lately the feeling had been creeping up on him that the galaxy was getting ordinary, that the commonplace was settling into it. One planet, one new species, one crisis with the Romulans was beginning to feel like all the others before it. Do I need a vacation? And where the hell do I go when the fringes of the known universe are getting boring? Well, that's getting handled. The screen changed views, and the flicker brought Kirk's attention back to it. Mr. Sulu had gone over to base sensors and was picking up their image of the Enterprise coming in. Kirk smiled at her, loving the stately lady for the thousandth time, and then was surprised when she abruptly went mischievous, 1,000 kilometers out from the base. The world stayed right side up, as usual inside the ship, but the base sensors showed her rolling slowly, luxuriously, on her longitudinal axis, one victory roll, then another, while overexcited ions screamed light in her wake.
"Belay that, Mr. Sulu," Kirk said, at some pains to sound stern. "This is serious business." "Aye, sir," Sulu said, looking soberly up and suppressing his smile as well.
He knew the captain had seen him setting up that maneuver and had said nothing. After all, look what ships were at 18. Some of them prime contenders for the drive, some of them old friends of the captain's, or old friendly rivals. USS Milton Humason, USS Alonwy, USS Challenger, and smaller ships that had worked with Enterprise before or crossed her path. Condor, Indomitable, QE3, look far. Sulu touched a control here, one there, and made the ship straighten up and fly right. Kirk let his own smile go no farther than his eyes, and watched their approach, which was so close now that Enterprise was blotting out most of the base sensor's sky. "Back to our visual for a moment, Mr. Sulu," he said. The screen changed again, to show one unspiked end of the huge structure irising open for them, revealing a portal that could have swallowed 20 starships side by side. All about the opening door, mirror-polished stanchions and spires glittered fiercely golden and hatched the surface and one another with razor-edged shadows. Kirk winced as base navigations guided them into the heart of the light. "Cut the intensity on that, would you, Uhura?" he said, averting his eyes, then glancing back when the brightness was handled. There was something about the great silver and gilt interior that drew the eye, and at the same time made the watcher nervous. "Well, it's the old thing about alien architectures. The place isn't Terran built, if built was even the right word, for the exterior skin of the base was really only a tight, fine mesh woven of what seemed, at this distance, delicate threads of mirror-finished steel, and were actually long single crystal extrusions, each 2 meters thick. From the skin, substructures hung, tethered by cables or jutting out on odd-shaped supports, looking like packages dangling or stuck on poles. They were offices, service bays, living quarters. All along the interior of the structure, little drones glided along twisting rails or sailed by on chemical propulsion,
flashing suddenly if they happened into a sunbeam piercing the interior through one of the many oddly placed apertures. Motion, haste, an impression of life that was quick and glittering and very alien, that was what Kirk got, along with a slight uneasy feeling at being closed in. But what am I thinking of? He chided himself a moment later, considering the folly of trying to understand much about another species just from its artifacts. He recalled the conclusions the Tegmanir had come to about Earth humanity from the single chair they'd found, and cautioned himself against judgments. Still, it was hard to believe they were only 75 light-years from Earth.
It's a lovely place they've got here, Scotty said, from where he stood beside the helm.
On the screen, shadows slid and flickered as Himal's fierce golden fire shone through and was occluded by the outer webwork of the starbase.
I'd like to meet the designers.
On the other side of the helm, Spock stood straight and still with his hands behind his back, looking unmoved and calm as always. But his eyes were for the screen as much as Scotty's.
You may have that chance, Mr. Scott. Two of the Homolki members of the base design team are also involved with the development of the inversion drive.
Thanks for telling me, Mr. Spock, Scotty said, looking very pleased and anticipatory.
Jim smiled to himself. A brief stint at a desk job with the Federation's Bureau of Planetary Works had only served to increase Scotty's absolute worship of excellence in design and everything. Meeting one of the Homolki designers, famed as among the finest in the known universe, would probably be akin to a religious experience for him.
How are we doing, Mr. Sulu? Kirk said.
A pilot's coming out for us, sir. ETA to dock is 5 minutes.
Sir, said Uhura from her post.
Base operations just called. Commodore Kathasat's respects, and it would like to see you in its office along with the chief engineer, and whatever other department heads will be involved with the installation proper.
Fine. Acknowledge, and tell it we'll be along immediately, docking is complete.
Here comes the pilot, sir, Sulu said.
They'll be belaying us in on tractors.
Uhura, advise all hands.
Done, sir.
Sulu touched his controls again, and the view changed once more on the screen as the Enterprise eased to a full stop, hanging there at the heart of the immense silvery structure. From off to one side, something small and bright shot out of a crevice in the shining weave.
Someone in a powered pod? Kirk thought, having his doubts.
The pod was hardly a meter wide.
The little gleaming egg fired itself along at the Enterprise, with such force and speed that for a moment Kirk feared for his outer hull. Yet barely a few meters from it, the egg snapped to a stop as sharply as if it had come to the end of a tether, and then inched delicately forward to touch the leading edge of the secondary hull. A moment later, it backed away again, leaving attached to the hull the bright, pearly line of something Kirk had heard of, but never yet seen. One of the new tactile tractors that were also of Homolki make. Spinning its glowing line, the egg headed back toward the semi-spherical docking bay that was the far end of the base, and actually towed the Enterprise behind it, inch by inch at the start, then with more speed, a slow glide. Kirk found that looking at impossibility made his mouth dry. Scotty, beside him, was near spluttering with delighted perplexity.
That cannot be done? I don't care what mode of force you're using.
Yet there it is, Mr. Scott, Spock said. Once again, size proves deceptive.
The operating principle is called elective mass. It is one of the assumptions that makes the inversion drive possible. He tilted his head to one side, watching the little glittering seed in utter calm. Certainly it looks unlikely. So do the equations involved, I assure you. Many of their elements trespass into what we have for some time considered impossibility, yet the drive works.
Makes your head hurt, does it? Jim said, shooting an amused sidewise look at the Vulcan.
Spock breathed out, shifting his shoulders a bit.
My somatic responses are hardly germane to the situation, Captain. It would be more accurate to say that there are facts I have yet to assimilate entirely.
There are?
Scotty said, grinning.
Spock didn't deign to answer that one, merely gazed at the screen, as they all did. The silver ovoid with its tractor pulled Enterprise deeper into the base. Abruptly, between the rounded, far bay and the ship with its tug, light sprang into being, lines of it. Lines making angles with one another, defining chords within the immense circle of the base's hull. 24 radial lines segmenting that circle, all meeting in the center, and woven among the radials, one by one, a dazzling confusion of oblongs and parallelograms of light. Straight at the glowing network, the little silver egg led the Enterprise, and finally, with only the tiniest jolt, right into it. Kirk let go of the arms of the helm, which he had been gripping. As he did, the framework of light came loose from most of its anchor lines and dropped slowly about the Enterprise, wrapping itself closely about both hulls, clinging wherever it touched. The silver ovoid slipped through the mesh and darted away, leaving behind it a starship bound tight in lines of pearlescent white fire that dimmed somewhat in brilliance, but still pulsed, very much alive. "That," Kirk said, getting up from his chair, "has to be one of the weirdest dockings I've ever had. Let's go see the Commodore. Uhura, you have the con." Kirk and Spock and Scotty headed for the lift. As its door whooshed closed behind them and Uhura slid into the command chair, Sulu turned to Chekov at the command console and gave him a wicked, merry look.
"Come into my parlor," said the spider to the fly.
Chekov rolled his eyes at the ceiling and idly began working out the initial parameters for the search and discover spiral in the next galaxy over. The Starbase's office complex was a little less exotic than its shimmering outworks. When the world came back after the transporter's glow was gone, Jim found himself standing in a very average transporter room. Not quite so average was the Sulamid chief engineer handling the console. He stood 3 meters high, a sheaf of constantly moving rose and violet tentacles, with 8 restless, stalked eyes peering about from the top of him. Lieutenant Commander stripes manifested themselves in the skin of the barrels of several of his larger handling tentacles, Sulamids being color changers of great skill.
"Sir, madams, welcome be," the Sulamid said with a graceful flourish and wreathing of tentacles, nodding several of them in a gesture of respect. "Down hall left, 3 doors lift. 4 level down, 2 left ways, exit rightward, 6 doors right, waiting Commodore Kathasat eagerly. Introduction, briefing, legal intoxicant. Sirs, madams, guide?"
"Thank you, mister," Kirk said, having doubts about the mister even as he said it. All 12 of the Sulamid sexes claimed to be male, especially the ones who had the children. "I think we'll manage." They did, though Kirk was astonished again and again on the way down by how many of the non-hominid kinds of people were on station. Himal was close to Sol and Terra, but it was also within the boundaries of the great Majoris Congeries, an intergalactic open cluster of 20 stars that was home to as many wildly diverse species, from methane breathers to one-winged species that found the atmosphere of stars congenial. There was a branch of Starfleet Academy here to service this sector of space, and a library secondary only to that of Alexandria II. The stable population was around 8,000 sentients, crewmen on assignment and their dependents, and civilians on vacation, for some of the base was a resort, privately financed and operated. The halls were noisy with translated and untranslated conversation, as various kinds of people chirped, squeaked, laughed, grunted, or howled about their business. Kirk found himself smiling as he went, for there was an excitement in the air abnormal for even such a place as this, and his ship was at the heart of it. The Commodore's office door was open when they came to it. Kirk tapped twice on the door sill and walked in, finding Kathasat getting up from behind its desk. It was a Hest, Afrukba 5, a tall being so slender as to look skeletal, with greenish-bronze skin stretched taut over a basically bipedal form. Hest had extra knees and elbows, and looked a touch peculiar to earthly eyes when they stood or sat. Their long, gaunt faces were adorned with large, gentle eyes, green or golden, that gave their faces a perpetually wistful look. Jim knew that look painfully well. Kathasat had used it on him enough at poker, with great success. "Commodore," he said, reaching out a hand and then putting it behind his back again in the Hest fashion. "Good to see you again."
"Under these circumstances, I believe it," Kathasat said in its whispery voice, matching Kirk's gesture and then reaching out to clasp hands with him. "Perhaps you would make me known to your officers."
"Commander Spock," Jim said, and Spock bowed, all reserved Vulcan courtesy. "Chief Engineer Scott," and Scotty copied Kirk's gesture, with Kathasat returned with the round mouth smile of its people.
"No shortage of good company," it said. "Captain, I have some truly astonishing Nihue I've been saving for some world-shattering occasion. Perhaps you gentle folk would join me."
There were all kinds of racks, supports, and chairs in the office. It took a few moments to find ones that fit, but as soon as they had, the Commodore was passing around glasses and a crystal flask half full of the dark blue Nuhue. Kirk was glad to see it, and poured himself a generous splash. Nuhue might taste like machinist oil, but it also contained a neuropressor hormone that in most hominid chemistries enhanced whatever emotional state the drinker was presently experiencing, hence its slang name, more of the same. Jim took a long drink and got more cheerful than he had been, and watched Scotty get more excited. Spock sipped his carefully and became more serenely unreadable by the moment. "Getting things started in a hurry, are we?" Kirk said. "Is Fleet pressuring you, Respected?"
No. The chief of the installation team, however, has asked to meet you as quickly as possible and get permission to start her work immediately." The Commodore hooted softly, a hissed laugh. "She says she's waited 800 years to get out of the galaxy, and she won't wait a day longer than necessary now that the problem is handled."
Kirk went over to the additions to crew roster in his head. That would be the Homalki, then. Something scrabbled politely at the door.
"Are they here? High time," said a voice that didn't so much speak as chime, a sweet, liquid, brittle chattering, staccato yet melodic.
The person who went with the voice came scuttling into their midst in a swift flow of delicate, much articulated legs, 12 of them, that were attached to a rounded central body. The being was an arachnoid, a big one, standing about a meter high on those legs, her body about a meter across and half a meter thick. That body was transparent in most places, translucent in others, made of an analog to chitin that was clear as glass. Most places, the creature's surface was polished to mirror smoothness. The exception was the upper side of the abdomen, where clear, needle-fine spines made a fur that glittered like grass on a dewy morning. The abdomen had a slender, nubbly ridge or crest running atop it from front to back, and in the ridge, 12 eyes were set. 4 clustered at one end, 4 at the other, 4 studded along the ridge. At first glance, they seemed expressionless, like a shark's, Jim thought, and repressed a shudder. Yet they also burned like blue-hot opals, full of shifting fires. And when one cluster of them fixed on Jim, he felt the personality behind them like a blow, and was impressed. "This is a power," he thought as he rose to greet her, and then added to himself, irrationally relieved, "My ship is in good hands."
"Captain Kirk, please sit," the wind chime voice said, as the Homalki settled on the floor in the middle of the group and tucked her legs in around her, folding them out of the way.
"A great pleasure. I've heard many good things about you. I'm Katulik."
"Thank you," Kirk said. "I only wish I were sure I could pronounce your name as well as you just managed mine, and even without a voter."
"No problem. Get the consonants right, and the vowels will take care of themselves. We only have one vowel anyway."
And she pronounced it, an E above high C, surrounded by shivery harmonics.
"And all the rest of the language is a matter of pitch. The same as yours, more or less."
The fiery eyes turned their attention to the first officer, and Kitalik lifted the 2 forward legs on that side to describe a swift gesture in the air.
"Mehe naket urseve. Mr. Spk."
He lifted his hand in a Vulcan salute. "May you also live long and prosper, madam. And may I compliment you on your accent?" She laughed in surprise, a merry chiming.
"If it warrants it, yes, indeed. Evidently, that correspondence course I took to read all those Vulcan engineering journals was better than I thought."
She looked over to Scotty.
"And greetings to you also, Mr. Skupt. Well met, indeed. A long time now I've wanted to meet the man who so many times has pulled the estimable captain's nuts out of the fire."
Jim put up an eyebrow. Scotty reddened and held his grin back from becoming a laugh.
"I thank you, lady," he said, "though it's not often been so dramatic."
"The idiom, though, would be chestnuts," Spock said, utterly deadpan.
"Oh, thank you."
"Where's your manners, Mr. Spock?" Scotty said in feigned shock. "Correcting a lady."
"Oh no, the correction's welcome, Mr. Scott," Kitalik said. "After all, language is what we build with, the tool that builds the tools. Inaccuracy there is as deadly as it be in a warp drive whose computer feeds it inaccurate mixed ratios. Architectrics keep any such fate far away from you, which brings me to the point. My technicians are lined up in the cargo transporters waiting for your permission to begin installing the inversion drive. May we?
Permission granted, of course. I'll give the orders, Kirk said, amused by the Hamalki's cheerful intensity. A question, though, before you go. Kathasat mentioned that you'd been waiting 800 years for this?
863 standard, Kitalik said. Towed your ship in myself so that no fool would damage it somehow and slow things down.
Are you fleet personnel, then? Kirk added, not much liking the idea of a person without Starfleet oaths in force touching his ship. Or civilian?
Both, Kitalik said. I comprehend your concern, Captain. In this life, I'm long retired from Starfleet, though I have a reserve commission as full commander. If you wish to reactivate it, I'm willing to serve with you, though the presence of stripes won't significantly affect my performance.
Kirk nodded. Scotty looked confused. This life? He said.
Kitalik gazed up at Scotty with what Jim would have sworn was a humorous look. Yes, indeed. I had to be hatched 4 times, each time with the previous life's memories added on, to get all this work done. The equations for the inversion apparatus and so forth. This last lifetime, the theory just suddenly began to put itself together, so I went and talked to the Vulcans, and among us we worked out the hardware for the drive. Now that that's done, I want to get out there and accept the consequences of my work. Or, preferably, enjoy them.
The Hamalki stood up, rubbing 2 back legs together in what looked like an impatient gesture.
Captain, I desire your better acquaintance, and there'll be more leisure for that once the apparatus is installed and we're on our way to the Lesser Magellanic.
Of course, Kirk said, gently amused.
Then I'd like to have the company and guidance of your officers in this business, if I might. I know your ship from stem to stern, from her plans, of course, but you gentlemen...
She fixed those blue hot eyes on Spock and Scotty.
We'll know where the bugs are.
Jim nodded at them in dismissal. Kitalik was out of the room in her 3 quick leaps. Spock and Scotty went after her, having to move fast to catch up.
I read that article of yours in Acta Mega Astrophysicalis last month, Spock,
the Hamalki's voice said in a hasty, good-natured chiming that dwindled down the hall.
The one about kinematics of nuclear regions in barred spiral galaxies. Where did you get that figure for the radial motion? The Tolle-Tele relation would seem to preclude...
Spock's unruffled voice could be heard beginning a reply as the doors to the Commodore's office slid shut. Kirk leaned back in his seat and pursed his lips in the gesture he knew Kathasat would read as a smile. I may not be seeing much of my first for a while, if that was any indication, he said. Looks like he's found someone who'll understand what he's talking about when he gets mathematical. Kathasat tilted its head to one side in Hest's acquiescence.
I hope so. The Hamalki have been claiming that the Vulcans' assistance made the inversion drive possible, but the Vulcans deny it categorically and insist they barely understood what the Hamalki were talking about. Understandable, I suppose. I can't imagine Vulcans being very easy about science called creative physics. Yet they got together, and now we have the drive. How do you feel about it, Jim?
Going extragalactic? He took another long drink of the Nui. Excited. Pleased. A little annoyed about the politics.
That our worlds have leisure for politicking, Kathasat said, round-mouthed, is an indication we're succeeding at our jobs. No nervousness?
Kirk shrugged and drank again, then put his glass down and looked at the Commodore. A waste of time, Katha. The Hest tilted its head again.
No change after all this time, it said. A long time since you and I flew together at Academy with our sleeves innocent of rank.
You were a good wingman, Jim sighed. I miss that sometimes, Katha. The freedom and the excitement.
I miss it too, Jim, but I've graduated to larger problems these days than a flitter's fuel mix and whatever nav comp will stay up and running long enough for me to find my way back to base. And so have you. Oh, Jim, that bland look of yours could fool a hint, but not me. You're headed a long way from anywhere on this mission, with no help to be had. And our friends the Klingons have been sniffing around the inversion drive's testing grounds with those new hyperphasers of theirs. Be careful, my friend.
Jim picked up his drink again, turned it around in his hands. Which Klingons?
Kaza was here a 10 day ago.
showing itself along the borders, then slipping out again. Earlier in the month, it was Kitten and Kichikiri, and a little convoy of support cruisers and cutters. Kitalik did her final test in a mid-sized craft, a cutter. Her test jump landed her right in the middle of them. It's well for us that she has good reflexes. Before they could react, she re-elected her mass in another direction and came out into real space, practically in the corona of a little white dwarf near Rasselgathi.
A cutter might need to run, Jim said. But the Enterprise won't. Let them come after us, if they can get up the nerve.
Don't ask for anything you're not willing to have happen, Kathasat said, its great eyes glinting with rueful humor at its friend. Jim, your command record shows that you're pretty much the same way you used to be at Academy. You can always fall into a fuy heap and come up covered in diamonds. This time, I'd rather you just cover yourself with glory, rather than take the chance of taking a header into a real fuy heap. Look over your shoulder. Be careful.
I read, Katha, I read. Enough. What is this fuy business? Do you talk to your mother that way?
Who do you think taught me? And when does the game start?
2000 our time.
There goes that last pay raise, Jim.
Wanna bet? My first officer taught me this system.
When Lieutenant Uhura called him and told him that the crew briefing was going to be held live on the recreation deck so that a full off shift could attend, Lieutenant Harb Tanzer's first reaction was to make a face at the work ahead of him in the next few hours. But the reaction didn't last long. His usual tendency toward humorous acceptance of circumstances had him laughing at the problem, and himself, within a few minutes. Without further ado, he left the little cubicle of offices that gave onto the rec deck, and went out to take down the forest. He stood and stretched outside the door for a moment, yawning. It was late in his own shift. Lieutenant Tanzer was a stocky, square-built man, muscular, but with the muscles padded and gentled by a smoothing of fat. He had the prominent nose and craggy features common to many Earth humans of the third diaspora, as well as the thick silver hair characteristic of those gallant mad early spacers who had so often dared deep space without appropriate shielding and had introduced some interesting mutations into their bloodlines as a result. Pale, close-set blue eyes looked out of that face. Eyes that could go fierce and piercing when the occasion called for it, or could crinkle at the corners and smile as delightedly as the mouth when hilarity broke loose, which was often. Harb was somewhat older than the usual Enterprise crewman, who tended toward early or mid-post-adolescence. In his job, however, age was less an issue than in some that required hair-trigger reflexes and athletic prowess. His job demanded a sense of humor, sharp wits, and a keen insight into people. In Harb Tanzer, all these were improving with age. He was chief of recreation, a small department, but an important one, on a starship. He let his arms fall and looked with affection and mild regret at the land space around him. The slim black boles of smooth-barked trees reared up and around, almost completely shutting the night sky away with their thick crowns of whispering leaves 50 feet above. Yet here and there a star winked through, big and bright. The starlight was in fact so bright that the leaves blocking it out cast clear, sharp shadows on the leaf-strewn ground, for this was a forest that grew on a world at the heart of the great R. Scuti cluster, where stars shone even in the daytime, and the night sky was a jeweled tapestry thick with slowly pulsing regular variables and novae, all huge and close. Harb had spent half his leave in that forest when they made planetfall there some months before, recording sounds and scents and textures with great care. I did good work, Harb thought, smiling with satisfaction as a breeze riffled through the leaves, and none of them showed holographic overlap or moiré patterns. From off in the direction of the lift entrance, attenuated by apparent distance, came the mournfully sweet cry of one of the nightingale bats, a shadowy, abstract melody like an oboe singing its private sorrows to the night. Underfoot, the tiny, white, five-petaled flowers of Eleanor mimicked the brighter stars above them and gave out their sharp, sweet fragrance to mingle with the other scents of the forest after rain. "It's all on tape," he said aloud to the pair of silver, fiery eyes that watched him from a high limb of the nearest tree. "I just hate taking it down." A pale shape in a gold uniform tunic slipped around the trunk of one of the trees, looking around him alertly and with delight. "Lieutenant?" "Here, sir," Harb said, and stepped out to meet the captain.
The encounter was hardly unusual. Recreation saw a lot of Captain Kirk, who played as hard as he worked, though, to Harb's constant concern, not nearly as much. Lieutenant Tanzer privately held the captain as special responsibility, someone to be amused and entertained as frequently and as thoroughly as possible. His immediate superior supported him in this, recreation being one of the departments of medicine and reporting directly to Dr. McCoy. "They told me it was marvelous," said Harb's favorite customer, turning to gaze up through the gently waving branches at the blooming, swelling, shrinking stars. "I see that they were understating." "What's that?" The captain pointed at the eyes that watched them from the nearby branch. "Night stalker, sir," Harb clucked at it. The logistics computer picked up the sound and changed tapes, so that the dark furry form inched forward into the starlight and peered at them with its big ears pricked up. It held the position for a few seconds, then made a mistrustful mewling sound and swarmed up the tree trunk out of sight. Captain Kirk shook his head, smiling. "That was in Scudham somewhere?" "Yes, sir. I forgot the star's name. Some little A7. We called the planet Lorien." "I remember that. I never did get down there. Too much to do." Lieutenant Tanzer nodded. It was the old story. Sometimes the man who ran the show didn't get to enjoy all of it. "But you have all this in tape, don't you, Harb?" "Yes, sir. At least in facsimile, you can go back." Kirk laughed. "Good, I will. Meantime, the Commodore is coming across from the base for an evening of cards." "It's Hesf, so you need cards marked for an infrared reader," Harb said. "What game, Captain? Star and Comet? Alioth? Fizbin?" "Poker." "Aye, aye." Lieutenant Tanzer gestured toward his office. Its door opened for them, letting a bizarre stream of everyday light into that midnight forest. "Half a moment," Harb said. He went over to his master logistics console and queried it for availability of poker supplies, noting that 3 sets were missing. One was in sickbay, in use, by the temperature readings he got from the cards. One was idle in hydroponics. The 3rd in engineering was also in use. Probably a few of Scotty's people were whiling away spare time while the Hamalki crew installed the inversion drive. A rack of chips and one of the 18 remaining packs of plastic cards sparkled into being on the transporter pad of the console. Harb picked up both chips and deck, made sure their charges were positive, then handed them to Kirk. The captain rubbed his hands on the cards, apparently enjoying their warmth after the cool of the forest outside. The cards would be radiating at Earth-human blood temperature for hours, all but the dark symbols on them, which Kathasat would read as shadows against luminous whiteness. "Thanks," the captain said, turning away, and then stopping. "Now, what the hell is going on down there?" Harb joined him, looking down into the little 27 cubic meter repeater tank in the corner, by which the big game's tank out in the rec room could be monitored for Games Master games, or just for kibitzing. The tank was full of stars that swooped and whirled and danced so violently that Harb's stomach protested a little at the image. The effect was as if someone was riding one of the ancient roller coasters of Terra, but through deep space instead of on a planet's surface, and with a fine disregard for which way up or down might be. Far out at the fringes of the tank vista, small lights that were not stars swooped and soared, diving toward the point of view at the front of the tank, veering away again. One area of cubic up in one corner showed a larger view of what was happening. The long, lean shapes of Romulan warbirds and Klingon-built vulture destroyers dove and fired at a lone little shape that rolled and twisted through a tortuous course to avoid their fire. Upper primary hull disk, lower secondary hull cylinder, upreaching nacelles.
"Mr. Sulu asked me to make him a special mock-up," Harb said.
"A battle simulation for Enterprise without the usual battle methodology. No popping out of warp and firing, then ducking back into warp and running to get behind someone. Evasive and attack maneuvers in normal space, on impulse power only." The captain shuddered visibly as the Enterprise and the tank ran straight at a Romulan who had just popped out of warp and then veered away from it at a wrenching speed and angle that made his bones groan in sympathy, while behind her the Romulan struggled to return and bring the forward phasers to bear on it.
"You can't do that in a ship this size," he said, watching in fascinated horror as the little Enterprise did a frightening duck and roll that left the Romulan behind her, shooting at the one that had just been in front of her.
"With all due respect, sir, if you see it happening, it can." Mr. Sulu was very careful about the elements of the program that had to do with what a starship structure can take. "It's true, the program walks the outer limit of the design criteria, but then that's what he wanted for the simulation. An unorthodox battle situation that would stretch a helm officer a little. The object of this game for him is not only to elude the attackers, but also to keep the ship from being ripped apart by centrifugal and centripetal force. The mad helmsman at the other end of the game threw the starship he was piloting straight away from his pursuers, let them gather in a pack behind him, and tear along on his trail. Three of them arced out at the vertices of a triangle to begin a standard englobement. The starship flipped end for end, breaking savagely on its forward thrust, and headed right into the pack that still followed directly behind. Panicked, they scattered, but not fast enough. The starship hit one of them. Point of view in the main tank winked out instantly, to be replaced by the computer simulation of the Enterprise and three Romulan vessels colliding at just under the speed of light. The explosion was impressive, to say the least. Where four separate matter-antimatter drives had been contained and then catastrophically released at high combined velocities, there was no expecting anything but a blast that would have burned any observer's eyes out, and then a slowly contracting ball of superheated gas and debris that for some time to come would do a creditable imitation of a star gone nova. Very sweetly, very sorrowfully, the Master Game's computer began to play taps. The sound of various observers' laughter, merry jeering and condolences, along with Sulu's annoyed swearing, came in through the tank circuit. The captain made a wry face. "They can laugh," he said to Harb, "but it's not their ship." "How long did it take you to set that up?" "A couple of weeks. It's only a prototype. Of course, if you'd like me to have the program added to your private terminal." Kirk smiled, a tight, tired expression. "I'm knee-deep in prototypes at the moment, Mr. Tanzer. But I suppose one more wouldn't hurt."
"I suppose not, sir. May I ask how the new drive's coming along?"
Kirk shrugged as they walked out of the office, a gesture half annoyance and half resignation. "It's not a drive, Mr. Scott tells me, but he's not sure what it is either. The Helmalki have the equations for it, but they don't understand how the results proceed from them, and they don't care. Mr. Spock says he doesn't understand even the equations. You'll hear at the briefing."
"Yes, sir."
"Speaking of which, all this has to come down." They stood together in silence in the moon-bright starlight, listening to the wind. "Wait till I'm gone," the captain said abruptly. "Nice job, Mr. Tanzer."
"Thank you, sir," Harb said to the back of the man, already walking briskly to the lift.
As its doors closed, Lieutenant Tanzer let out a small breath of satisfaction, for there was more spring in the captain's step than there had been lately. "Wyra," he said to the air. "What is it, Harb?" the game's computer said. "We've got a briefing in here, scheduled 0.9. Estimated attendance is 230. Implement preparation procedures for the room."
"Do you have positive storage on the forest?" the quiet female voice said.
"Storage is positive. I tell you three times and once more for luck."
"Good. Hate to lose all those hollows I took."
"You took? Who ran around the planet holding the camera? Who told you where to shoot?" the computer said sweetly. Harb wondered briefly, for the hundredth time, whether it had been wise letting that skinny guy from artificial intelligence install that, for argument's sake, in his master computer. Then again, he thought, I need to play too.
"Wyra," he said, "is it true what I hear, that human beings are just what computers use to reproduce themselves?"
"You're catching on," Myra said, chuckling wickedly. "Striking the forest." Trees went out, flick, leaving nothing but leaf-scattered ground and shadowy hills against the horizon. The ground went out, revealing a dark carpet. The horizon blinked out, so that only the glorious sky remained, the many-colored gems swelling and shrinking in silence. Finally, the stars went out too, revealing about an acre of burnt orange carpeting, cream and gray panels 4 stories high, and the great observation windows full of golden light and shadows, the interior of the starbase.
"So much for Lorien," Wyra said, sounding a bit sad.
"We'll put it back up when we get underway again. Meantime, wake up the drones and send them in." Harb headed out across the huge expanse of the floor, toward the alcove where the big game stank was. "I'll enlist some assistance from the Starship Demolitions Corps over there. We got a lot of chairs to set up before 0.9.
Captain's Log. Stardate. Sometime in May 2020. So this is the place where I get to add a couple of my notes that I jotted down while reading Chapter 2. First of all, it's, I don't know, kind of cool to think about the Enterprise going on basically mail runs, just doing run-of-the-mill tasks that have to be done for administrative reasons, and probably most of what it does are things like this. We only ever see it in the height of action and exploration, so Yeah, there's an administrative side to all that. Mr. Sulu's victory rolls were quite cute. When they were being towed into that weird space station, and Scotty was like, "That cannot be done!" It took me a moment to figure out what it was that he was talking about exactly, because there had just been so much description about the tow line that my brain thought Scotty was trying to wrap his head around that technology. But then I realized it was the sheer size difference between the Enterprise and the tiny one-person pod that was towing it. The difference in mass between the two vessels is what should have made it impossible, so that's what Scotty was kind of going on about. Would an accurate parallel be a flea dragging an elephant along by a leash? I don't know. Might not be too far off. Let's see, next, when Enterprise was docked as though caught in a spider's web, I was a little worried that it would end up being a trap, but I felt better when I saw the relationship that Kirk has with Kuthasat. They go clear back to the Academy, so I think they're safe. Kitalik is interesting, kind of like a giant spider. And on the back cover of this book, she's described as a pretty alien scientist. So either that's incredibly forward-thinking and open-minded in 1983 when this book was published, or the person who wrote the blurb just assumed she'd be a buxom blonde going by the stereotypical guest stars on the original series. I don't know. Either way, I really like her. The holodeck scene sounds really lovely. I don't remember the original series having a holodeck, and this book predates The Next Generation, so if Diane Duane came up with this independently, kudos. And they'd never be able to pull me away from the holodeck. I'd never get anything done. Finally, that little simulator battle that Sulu was working on, where a model of the Enterprise was in battle with Klingons and Romulans, I think, perhaps, were in there as well. So Enterprise has no warp, so he's trying to figure out different strategies for battle. I'm calling Chekhov's phaser right now. This is gonna show up later. I can feel it. Alright, thanks everybody. I hope you enjoyed this chapter of The Wounded Sky by Diane Duane. Keep an eye out for future chapters coming up soon.